So, in case you guys don't know, this is Matt. Welcome, Matt, a.k.a. Master Ken here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So, the man behind the mythos. By the way, you really inspired me. You really, really inspired me. When I first saw your stuff back in the day, I said, I don't think I can match that humor, but I want to be able to bring out my humor the same way that Matt does as Master Ken. So, big, just thank you, man. If I didn't see you on YouTube, I would have never. A lot of people who know, I used to be funnier, and then kind of the way YouTube is, I had to tone down some of my humor. But a lot of it was inspired by Master Ken.
Thank you. Well, that's wonderful to know, and I really appreciate hearing that anybody watches my stuff, likes my stuff, and the idea that anybody's inspired by the work that I've been able to do is wonderful. Wonderful to hear, because I really didn't know what I was doing when I started the YouTube thing. It was just kind of an emerging. I mean, the channel's old enough now that it was kind of just another option to try to get people to see my work, and so it took off in a way that I couldn't have anticipated.
Yeah, exactly. So let's start from the beginning. So when you were a kid, were you one of those like karate kids, or did you sort of discover martial arts a little later?
So I was a fan of martial arts movies pretty early on. I loved movies in general, and then I began to discover the martial arts action genre. I was a big fan of movies like Bloodsport with Jean-Claude Van Damme, and you know, the early Steven Seagal stuff, you know, Above the Law and Hard to Kill and Out for Justice and all that. And even some of the more, you know, what I think are technically sort of more obscure. Then I just started like looking for anything that had martial arts in it, and kind of like navigating the lower tier of martial arts movies where, like, you know, low budget stuff or just unknown things. You know, I was a fan of Jeff Speakman and The Perfect Weapon, and Thomas Ian Griffith and Excessive Force, I think it was called, Billy Blanks and King of the Kickboxers, just watching like whatever I could to just kind of, I was just into martial arts. But then I started to have, when I was a teenager, kind of had an attitude problem, kind of had a smart mouth, and had a lot of energy that wasn't going into positive directions and stuff. And actually, you know, we've gotten into a couple of scuffles that I lost, by the way. Mm-hmm. You know, like I got, you know, mouthed off and then got smacked around a little bit and wanted to learn how to fight. And I told my mother I wanted to learn how to box. And she told me she couldn't find a boxing gym, which I don't think was true, because there's a very well-known boxing gym in Lewiston, about 20 minutes from where I grew up. But she found a martial arts dojo. And I think she sort of felt that might be better for me to take karate, just because of the sort of perception of humility and discipline and things like that. I don't think she wanted me to become a fighter. And I took to it immediately. I was so excited that I was learning karate. It was very, very hard, but I enjoyed it. And I liked that I started in a really traditional style, that it was Okinawan Kempo. So very, very similar to Shorin-Ryu or Goju-Ryu. So we had kata, we had empty hand forms, weapons forms, we had self-defense techniques and scenarios, and then sparring. It had kind of had it all. But in a very traditional setting. And I think it was the best thing that could have happened to me at that age to get into that. It was good for me physically. It was good for me mentally. I'm glad that happened.
Yeah. And it's funny. So a very quick little thought I had was, so I took a break in my teenage years from my martial arts journey. And that led to a lot of kind of just mental anguish. So it's great that sort of in your teenage years you really got into it. If I could go back in time and really redo it, I would have not quit my martial arts journey in the middle of my teenage years and had to rediscover it as an adult.
I can understand that. What style was it?
I did a bunch of kung fu styles.
Oh, cool. Yeah,
and I did a little karate, but it was more like a coworker of my dad teaching me karate. So yeah. I didn't even know what style. He was just like, you know, I He I guess because I hung out at my dad's office all the time. So he's like, oh, I'm learning karate. Let's teach Jerry some karate. So, but I will say, and this is what I told Sensei Seth, is that the little bit of karate I did helped me out in fights way more than kung fu. Not to say kung fu didn't help me, but because in karate you do those compliance drills, which everyone loves to talk smack about, but actually for a little kid, it's really good for the muscle memory. And it helped me at least in one fight.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. I still to this day, when I do spar, which I don't, you know, I spar sometimes at the I train at a primarily a jiu-jitsu gym, but we do have we have some nights where we do I guess essentially MMA rounds where, you know, I'll get up there and spar, and I still draw on my karate basics a lot of the time, and still find that like it's there's a lot of aspects of karate that are pretty useful, you know, in terms of the basics of striking that are really useful. But I definitely agree that particularly for teenagers, you know, who have a lot of energy and a lot of emotion, and they're figuring out who they are, and they're trying to manage, you know, a lot of very normal angsty kind of feelings and energy, that like to have something like martial arts to channel it into, I think is so healthy. It's so good to like, cause I feel like it's one of the safest ways to have dangerous play, you know, like there are rules, there's oftentimes protective equipment, there's things that help keep young people as safe as you can reasonably keep them while also doing a kind of, you know, a slightly dangerous sport. So yeah, I bet that was a tough time to not have that. And I'm glad you got back into it.
Yeah, exactly. And I think this is the perfect time to kind of explore the other side of Matt, which is, when did you discover your love for acting? You know, you built this amazing Master Ken character. Tell me about, was the love for acting sort of parallel to your martial arts journey, or did you discover it later?
Yeah, it was kind of happening at the same time. You know, I was, when I grew up, I was a creative kid. I would watch movies and then like mimic the things that I saw in movies. I would do impressions and things like that and slapsticky things. I used to rent video cassettes of The Three Stooges. There was three episodes per cassette, and I would like rent those and watch the episodes, and then I would mimic the stuff that I saw in there and make my friends laugh, sometimes in class, which was very disruptive to my teachers, which I feel bad about in retrospect. But I learned, I knew that I liked performing. I knew that I liked making people laugh. I would also draw my own comic books. I would collect comic books. I discovered comics like The Punisher and Daredevil and things like that when I was young. And also some DC stuff. I liked, I had a few Batman comics. I liked, Dark Horse, the Alien comics and the Predator comics and stuff like that. But I would then draw, I would create my own comic book characters or martial arts fighter characters. And I would, in school, when I had an art project, it was like, okay, well, I'll just draw a little comic book. So I would just draw out all the frames and then fill them with like little stories and things like that. So I always enjoyed being creative. Mm-hmm. And then my interest in martial arts was developing at a parallel time, but I didn't really know how to fuse those. I will say that the few times that I did, I felt like I always got the biggest response. I didn't pay attention to for many, many years. I made a bunch of short films in high school. My mother got me a video camera when I was 16 years old, and I figured out how to edit between two VCRs and make little movies and stuff. And I made a series of little silly spoof movies. But one of my favorite ones that I made was one where I got to do some karate in it, and like people really responded to that. So I didn't know how to meld those for many, many years. It wasn't until after I went to film school and learned a lot about the filmmaking process that I didn't know, and how the tools worked and all the different jobs that were involved in making something. It wasn't until after I graduated from there that I tried again to meld my interest for filmmaking and acting with my interest in martial arts.
Wow. And I think this is the perfect time to elaborate on film school, because that's awesome. You went to film school. Was it a 4-year program? Was it an MFA or did you do both?
It was a bachelor's program. It was 4 years. It was at a place called College of Santa Fe, which doesn't exist anymore. I didn't know you could go to a college. I didn't know colleges went out of business. It was a great school. It was the degree is technically in moving image arts, and it was a really unique program because it was simultaneously they taught us a lot about how the standards of production worked. The cinematography classes, we were all divided up into, you know, 1 week who the cinematographer was going to be and who the camera operator was going to be and who the first AC and the second AC and the gaffer, like we all had different jobs. And then that on the next project, we would all switch so we could learn what each job was on a functioning film set. And then we also had really esoteric abstract classes like alternative screen, the class was called, where we would watch the most bizarre experimental films, things that were hard to find and things that were so outside the norm for a lot of us, that really expanded our view of what the moving image could be. And so that was really fantastic. So I kind of, it opened my eyes creatively to a lot of what you can do with the visual medium, but also gave me enough of an education about how, I guess, the professional standards of how a movie set or a TV set would work. So it really prepared me, and it allowed me to improve my work. That was the main thing. I was talking about, I think I was talking to my girlfriend about this recently, but I remember before I went to film school, one of the things that would frustrate me was I couldn't figure out why what I saw in my head wouldn't translate to what I was creating. And I would, you know what I mean? I could see the scene was so perfect in my head, and this shot is cool and that shot is cool. And then I would make it and like, it didn't quite look so good. And the lighting wasn't quite right. And, you know, there were some sound problems and I didn't know what I didn't know. So I went to film school to be like, why doesn't my short film look like the movie that I just went to see? Is it all about money or is it about how I use the tools? And luckily what I learned, particularly at the time that I was going to film school, I graduated in 2005, the digital revolution was happening where the tools were getting higher and higher quality. They were getting more and more accessible. They were getting cheaper and it was becoming easier to make high quality content without having a ton of money. And so I was at this perfect time where I learned, I'm grateful that I was right at the cusp of it because I learned how to shoot 16 millimeter film. We would shoot Super 16 and I learned how to load film mags and how to take light meter, you know, using how to use an incident meter and a spot meter and like you learn how to like light a scene. But then I was also learning the digital tools that were about to replace all that stuff. So it was a really great time to be learning that craft. And I feel like I've been able to apply so much of what I learned in film school in my craft that I do even now.
Yeah, I think what you really got was the best of both worlds, because a lot of us who went to college a little later, unless we really tried, we couldn't get the film classes. All our stuff were digital. I took one film photography course and that was it. I didn't have any film camera courses because we didn't have any film cameras. So you got to see both. You got to see the traditional way and the new way. And the traditional way can only complement the new way. The more you know, the better. It's like gi jackets in jiu-jitsu versus no-gi. If you learn gi, it'll help you with no-gi.
That's a fantastic comparison because like, and actually I find both using film and training in the gi to be tedious and actually quite satisfying at the same time, because I find it to be a little bit harder. I find, you know, going through the steps that you have to go through to get to use film and film equipment and get an exposure and get it developed and get all that stuff. And then when you get it back, it looks really cool. And I find the same thing that like, I used to actually only train in the gi. It's actually only the past 2 years that I've really been training in gi and no gi jiu-jitsu. And I hated no gi when I started. And now when I have to put on the gi, I'm like, oh man, this is so much harder than no gi. Because, and yet I find it when I do, learn takedowns or submissions that involve the gi, I find them to be harder to do, but more satisfying when I do get them because they require, in some ways, I don't know. There's a whole level of technical proficiency that applies to both.
Exactly. One thing I'll make sure to do after this interview is I have a list, a spreadsheet of like obscure film studies films that I am trying to get through. So I'll show you that list because what happened in college for me was I didn't want to be a film major because obviously it was like, I don't think that would have been approved of by my parents. But
Right.
I would sit in on the first day of a lot of film classes just to get the syllabus. So I kept all the syllabus because I knew one day it would inspire me. So when I went home last year to my parents' house, I found the syllabi and I was writing in all those books, all those movies recommended. I'm like, I'm gonna watch them one day.
I would love to see that list because I'm still, I mean, I had to accept when I was in toward the end of my film school career, I had to like except that I was just never going to be able to watch everything that I wanted to watch because there was so much. There was so, like, it opened my eyes to how many contributions there are to the world of film. And that's without trying to do research on YouTube about what's going on YouTube and what creators are doing now. But when I discover new films, well, old films that are new to me, I still really enjoy that process. I'll throw out one example really quickly. It's William Friedkin's movie, The Sorcerer. The one he made after The Exorcist.
Oh,
And
okay.
it's not at all about what anybody thought it was about, which is why it tanked at the time, apparently, because he made The Exorcist and everybody said, oh, he makes supernatural, scary devil movies. And
Yeah.
then he made a movie called The Sorcerer, which turned out to be about a bunch of guys trying to deliver some precious cargo through the jungle.
Oh, yeah. There was another film that it sort of remade. Yes, I have that Wages of Fear movie saved on my to-do list. So Sorcerer's the remake. That's crazy. I just found this out. This is awesome.
And so it's so and free the movie came up in conversation since William Friedkin just passed away recently. The local theater here, the Guild Cinema in Albuquerque, played Sorcerer, and I had never seen it, and it was such an incredible experience. It's such a brilliant film. It's a slow film. It's a slow burn. It takes about 30 or 40 minutes to really get going, but it's so gritty, and it's like it's beautifully shot and it's beautifully acted, and it's the film that he wanted to be remembered for much more than The Exorcist. But that's just one example of a film that I've heard about for years that I heard was actually the better of the William Friedkin movies. Like, I love The Exorcist, but they were like, you got to see The Sorcerer because that's the one that really shows his skill as a filmmaker. And then I finally saw it and was blown away. So.
That's perfect. I guess I'm putting that on my list because HBO Max or now whatever it's called, that app that HBO has, it has a lot of these old movies. So that's where I've been finding a lot of these old movies.
They have like, I don't know if is it still called like the Turner Classics section, but they have,
Probably.
They have like a bunch of old movie, and I'm still discovering this. I don't even know if your audience wants to hear about any of this, but like, well, I'll get back to martial arts in a second. But well, this is related to martial arts.
Yeah,
It's
it
like I
is.
never heard, for instance, when The Mandalorian came out, I had heard people saying, well, this is kind of a, whether you want to call it an homage or a ripoff of, it's a samurai series. It's The Wolf and the Cub. Is that what it's called? I'm going to look it up.
Yeah, very likely. The Wolf and the Cub is like a whole series of samurai movies. Yeah.
It's Wolf and I think it's called Lone Wolf and
Yeah,
Cub.
Lone Wolf and Cub.
And they were like, well, this
Yeah.
is really just Lone Wolf and Cub, but with a baby Yoda. And
With
I
a
was like, what are
baby.
you talking about?
Yeah.
And then I went back and watched all the Lone Wolf and Cub movies, and they're amazing. They're incredibly shot, they're incredibly acted. The action goes from like being really gritty and yet ridiculous. They're just brilliant. They're brilliant films. And I had never heard of them until somebody made the comparison of Mandalorian. So I love discovering, and the fact that there's like, I think there's like six of them, discovering that there's still so much to watch and be inspired by.
Yeah, exactly. So I think this is the perfect segue. How did Master Ken, the character, come about?
So Master Ken had kind of a, it was something that I didn't realize I was collecting information about Master Ken because I didn't really know that that was the way it was going to come to fruition. But when I decided to try out YouTube, I tried three times before I figured out anything about it. I started three channels. I started a personal channel where I just kind of uploaded some of my short films from film school and nobody watched. You know, be like, I'd upload some film that took me like 6 months to make, you know, some 3 minute film that took me like 6 months of like planning and shooting and editing and re-editing and everything. And I'd get like 200 views. And then I started a channel for my company, Riffraff New Media, my production company, because I was doing like corporate videos and promotional videos and things. And I would throw little short films up on there. And those that got more views. I had a few views get into the, a few videos get into the thousands. And I was like, okay, there's something, you know, there's something here. And actually one of the things I accidentally discovered was I did a commercial for the American Kempo School that I was training at in Santa Fe. Tony and Erica Potter, who have a Jeff Speakman franchise up in Santa Fe. I did a commercial for them and that video got like 20,000 views. And I was like, oh man, okay. That was when I started to understand like, okay, so it's not just the content that I'm creating. It's the audience. You have to identify an audience that is looking. I thought, oh, there must be a lot of people that like Kempo online. So that got me a bunch of views. And so I wanted to create at the time what was called a web series. You know, I don't think we really use that term anymore, but like at the time it was like people were creating episodic content and putting it on YouTube. And I worked on a couple of my friends' web series and I really liked the idea. I liked the process. But what I was nervous about was I saw with both of the series that I worked on that they shot an entire season of the show before they identified their audience. So both shows struggled in the later releases of their episodes because they were in this weird position where it's like the first, you know, they got all their friends and family and even caught some, you know, some casual viewers and stuff to watch the first two or three. But if they still had a dozen episodes left to release and the views start going down, it's like, well, we've already shot these. Like, what do you do with them? Like, and then like, you know, and it was a shame. So I thought, okay, I want to do a web series, but I'm going to shoot a test. I'm going to shoot a test in a studio with me as Master Ken. So I did something that's actually only on my Riff Raff New Media YouTube channel. It's not on the Enter the Dojo Show channel. And it's the camera test for Master Ken. And so it's a little bit different than what the character is today. I wore a black uniform. I have the mustache, but I'm not doing the voice yet because I hadn't figured out the character. But I shot some silly stuff in a studio and then I edited it together and I sent it to my friends and I was like, if this sucks, I need you guys to tell me because I want to do a series based on this, but I don't want to do it if this sucks. So I did this so that you can tell me this sucks so that I don't waste a bunch of time. And several of my friends were like, most of them actually were like, this is really funny. You should do more of this. And actually my buddy Alejandro Montoya, who's a great filmmaker himself, said, I feel like your character could be wackier. I feel like you should go further with the character. So I thought about that. I was like, okay, so I did like a voice and a posture and the eyebrow thing. I started like exaggerating who the character was. And that was when Ken really started to take shape. And so then what I did is I wrote a script that was about 20 pages long. It was about the length of a sitcom. And I got a bunch of friends together, some talented crew members, some talented actors. And I got them together for one weekend. And I asked my buddy Joe Conway, who plays Todd Woodland, the faithful assistant of Master Ken. He had just opened a school at a new location in Albuquerque, and it was this huge facility. And I was like, hey, man, I got this idea about this show, and I'd really love to shoot it at your dojo. Would you mind if I did that? It's going to be a real low-budget production, you know, but we'll just be there for the weekend. And he said, I'll let you do it on one condition. I said, what's that? He said, can I be in the show? And I was like, of course you can be in the show. I need people in the show. Please be in the show. And initially he was just kind of a background character. But by season two, he came to me. I went to him, you know, saying that I wanted to do another season, and he came to me and it was like, so I got an idea about something that I want to try. I came up with this name for my character and stuff, and I was like, do it. Let's shoot it. And he came up with the name Todd Woodland and a little bit of a backstory. And it's funny because when we first developed that character, he talked a lot. Like a lot of people knew him to have dialogue. It was only later on, years later, when some of the videos where he didn't really say anything went viral. And so we kind of were like, I mean, it's becoming like kind of a Laurel and Hardy sort of thing where like I say all the silly stuff and then he's the slapsticky reaction guy. That's sort of how that developed. But anyway, you know, when we did the first episode of Enter the Dojo, I released it and I sent it to a bunch of martial artists. And that was the first thing I'd ever done that was garnering a lot of momentum very quickly, where people liked it, they shared it, they commented on it, and people were saying, oh my God, I know a Master Ken. I trained with a Master Ken at my Taekwondo school, or I had a drill sergeant that was exactly like Master Ken. That was when I found out I had tapped into something that was kind of universal, is that everybody had met a Master Ken at some point in their career.
And I think that actually answers my follow-up question. So it seems like this Master Ken character wasn't based on a specific person. It was more like you fused based on a lot of types of archetypes that you see, especially at schools or institutions that might have a head character that could potentially get culty, right? That's sort of what
Yes.
you fused together.
Yeah, I sort of Frankensteined the qualities and tropes and stereotypes of some things and based them on some experiences I had had in real life. I tell people that, you know, when I moved to California briefly to try to get into film out there, I was living in Anaheim Hills, and I saw that there was a martial arts school, you know, within walking distance. So I thought, okay, that's where I'm going to go because I'm broke and I just need a close place to train. And it was run by a guy who said he had been a Green Beret and he had created his own martial art. And he said, here we only do groin sparring. I thought he was kidding. And he's like, no, that's the only target that matters in the street. And so then, like, and we did that. Like, I participated in groin sparring where whoever grabbed the groin area of the uniform on the other opponent first wins. And I was like, this is bizarre. This is the craziest thing I've ever seen. And yet, the more I bounced around in my 20s and like I would move to a new area of LA, or when I moved out of LA, I would just like sort of go to the local dojo. And some of them were great places and some of them were full of crazy people that did bizarre things. And so over the years, I just collected all of these anecdotes and bizarre stories that ended up becoming the show.
One of the coolest things that I will say that Matt's comedy gets right is in your episode where you're sort of saying why Kempo is BS, right? One of your items is, yeah, the higher the belt, the more they have to gain the weight, right? And
Right.
what makes me laugh about that is I know a Kempo person, I'm not gonna say who he is, but he was like model looking back in the day, okay? But now that he's like a multi Don Black, but I don't think I'm using stripe. Let's just say stripe. A multi-stripe black belt. He looks like a Kempo professional, even though he was like model looking in his younger days. So I'm like, wow, even the model looking karatekas end up becoming like the Kempo stereotype.
You know, and one of the strengths of Master Ken is that because he was a character, he could get away with saying the thing that everybody knows to be true, but that might be hard to point out yourself, especially if you study at a Kempo school, you know, especially if you're talking about somebody in your lineage, like it would be considered kind of rude to point something like that out. But Ken, Master Ken doesn't give a damn. Like he'll say whatever the most controversial thing is, that again, that everybody can observe to be true, but Ken gets away with it. And so that was the power of the character when I started doing more videos where I was sort of talking to the audience, because initially it was in sort of a sitcom format, and then we needed more content. The audience was asking for more content. So I started the essentially the series we ended up calling Your Art is Bullshit, you know, where Master Ken would sit down and give the top five reasons why this martial art is bullshit or that martial art is bullshit. And it became a way to pick on people. And those videos got a ton of views, mostly because they really pissed people off. And so that was really good for the views and making observations about each martial art that people, again, knew to be true, but couldn't say themselves.
And that was actually the perfect follow-up. That's what I was going to ask next. I know the Krav Maga episode really angered people, but were there any other episodes that really angered people?
Man, Krav Maga and ninjutsu. Ninjutsu was the ninjas online get so mad. The ninja one was the first, I think that was the first one we released. And I remember we were about to do our first live performance as a cast. We had got invited to an event called the Bob White Invitational in California, which was a fundraiser for the Royal Family Kids Camp. It was a good cause. And they asked us if we could do a live version of our show at their banquet dinner. And we had no idea how that was going to go, but we decided to go try it. And we were getting ready to leave, and I had released the ninjutsu is bullshit video the night before. And I woke up and the video already had like 10,000 views or 15,000 views. And I was like, wait a minute, what? Like nothing we had released had gotten 15,000 views overnight. But it was pissing people off so much that they were all sharing it. And there have been several, but I will say the Krav Maga folks and the ninja folks are the people who seem to get the most upset the fastest. I make fun a lot of MMA people too. And I think the reason they don't get that upset is I feel like they kind of know like their stuff is legit because they go into the ring. That's their job, you know, is to go into the ring and prove themselves. So like the MMA people are often really good sports about that stuff because they're not really threatened by it, you know? So yeah, it's interesting the different reactions we get depending on who we're making fun of.
Yeah, I remember when I first started Fight Commentary Breakdance and I would roast people. It was always the MMA people who would be like, Jay, why don't you ever roast us, please? They would offer to be roasted. And I'd be like, I don't know what to roast about you. But they'd be like, Jay, roast my hair in this fight. Roast, you know, like they wanted it. Whereas all the other people would get mad.
Yeah, and that's interesting too, right? Because it really is, you know, there's this, I think it's really great to study some kind of martial art. I think it's really great. I think it's good mentally. I think it's good physically. But there are some martial arts, particularly the ones that fall more into the sport category, like because they fall into the sport category, they can prove themselves. They can go out and, you know, whether they're, and, you know, even something like Taekwondo gets a bad rap, but Taekwondo's in the Olympics. Like people get knocked out by Taekwondo kicks in competition all the time. So you can at least, you know, you can at least show that there is some application to that. There's in karate, you know, there's plenty of types of karate that might not help you if you've never practiced them in sparring, but then there's Kyokushin. Kyokushin people are incredibly tough. That Kyokushin sparring, there's no pads. People are getting kicked in the head and knocked out all the time. They get knocked out with those rib punches, you know what I mean? Like, and so there's categories of all these martial arts that are genuinely competitive where you can go out and test yourself. And I feel like the people who are in that world love poking fun because they don't really feel threatened by that idea. Whereas I feel like, you know, some of the arts where they don't test themselves very often, I think it's more likely for them to be a little maybe insecure about whether or not what they're doing is being taken seriously.
Yeah. And one of the best things you did was you made a follow-up to that Krav Maga video. Krav Maga is still BS. I'm like, yeah, that's how you do it. Were they more kind the second time or were they still pretty angry?
I think it had died down by then. In fact, like I tried to bring back some of the, I liked doing those. I liked doing the ones where I poked fun at martial arts, but they, I think there was a particular time. I feel like the timing when the channel was newer, it was better received. I brought that format back a few years ago, and they were okay. They did okay, but they didn't get the response that I'd hoped for. So I sort of felt like, eh, maybe there was a window of time where people were really excited about those, and now the format has kind of played. So I still think they're all really fun to do. I really like them.
I think one of your biggest hits for a while was the 100 Ways to Attack the Groin, right?
Yes.
How did that come to be? I mean, it seems like it was a natural progression, but what was the filming like for that one?
So that one was really interesting. That came about because we were approaching our 100th upload on YouTube, and I saw that other creators did something special for that. And so I thought, okay, well, we should do something too. And I had this other kind of dumb idea where it was like, well, maybe we have like a birthday candle with 100 can a birthday cake with 100 candles on it. And maybe that like that catches fire and sets off like the smoke alarm or the sprinkler system or something in the dojo catches fire. And I was like, God, we can't really do that. It's going to be like special effects and it's going to be this pain in the ass. And so Joe Conway, who plays Todd, he and I were kind of sitting around getting ready for coming up with something. And I was like, what if I just punched you in the dick like 100 times? And he was like, that's funny. And I was like, yeah, cool. Okay. the thing that I remember about that is we were trying to get people to help us because it was at the time I wasn't used to having to do everything, having to set up the lighting and set up the camera and play the role and everything. So I wanted some help. So I got some interns from the local film program, and they came down to help. One of them was helping with camera, and he brought his girlfriend, and she wanted to help. And she said, "What can she do?" I said, "You know what would be so helpful for you to do? Just count how many different ways I hit him in the groin, so that we don't lose track. Because I'm gonna forget what number we're on." She said, "Okay." So we filmed for an hour, and I said, "Okay, how many is that?" And she looked at her clipboard, and she went, "17." And I was like, "17? We just spent an hour. Oh my God, we're gonna be here for 2 days." Like I okay, so never okay. So I stopped overthinking it. I was like, we gotta stop overthinking it. We just gotta come up with a bunch of them. So we filmed like the next, what would that be? 83. I filmed like the next 83 in like the next 2 hours because I was like, we gotta move faster. This is gonna take way too long. And it was one of those videos that I thought was fine. I thought it was funny. I liked it. Even when I edited it together, I showed it to a couple people and they were like, "That's funny. That's good. That's cool." But I didn't, I, nobody that saw it and nobody and me and Joe weren't thinking, "Oh, this is going to be the video we're known for." It was just another video to release. And so when we released it was one of those things where the views just kept going and kept going. They were going up so fast that every half hour we were texting each other with the view count. Because it would jump by 50,000 views, 100,000 views, like every half hour. And we were like, oh my God, this is going viral. We finally did it. We did it, we made a viral video. And so that was the first video that hit 1 million views on the channel. It also was the first video that really gave us a sense of what was possible with the channel, because we had gone to I don't know that they have this anymore, but there was a place called YouTube Space in LA that was a studio. Do they still have that? I don't think they do. Do they?
I don't know because by the time I was popular enough to use it, I didn't need it, so I
Yeah.
haven't checked up on it for many
Same
years.
thing. Same thing. When we first went there, the barrier for entry, the bar for entry was like 10,000, and we had I think 28,000 subscribers, so we were still the lowest tier. And they explained to us, okay, 10,000 gets you in the door. 100,000 gets you to the mid-level stages, and then 1 million you can use the big stages. And I was like, well, we don't have to worry about it. There's no way we're ever going to get 100,000 subscribers. That's crazy. And then, like, I think later that year, we released the 100 Ways to Attack the Groin, and we went from 28,000 subscribers to 60,000 subscribers in like 2 weeks. And so all of a sudden, I was like, oh, this is absolutely attainable. Like we just got more than halfway there in 2 weeks. So it's about going, like if you have the right moment, your subscribership can just surge and then you can gain access to things. And so that was one of the biggest things that happened for us with that video, was that people suddenly knew who we were, they knew our channel, and I saw yet again how a channel could expand very, very quickly if you caught the right moment with the right type of content.
Exactly. So the final Master Ken character question I have is, you uploaded one time some highlights of when you went on America's Got Talent. What happened there? Why did they only give you highlights? What happened to the whole audition?
Oh my God. That was such an experience. So that was a tough one because it was something where we felt like it could be a really great opportunity for the show. You don't get paid, and they involve you. I had no idea what to expect, but they reached out to us because they were looking. It was like season 11 by that point. So they were, they needed acts, they needed people. So they reached out to us. We went to Arizona for an audition, which was weird because it was an audition, but they also had like the actual audition space, which was just some empty banquet rooms with like some desks and chairs. And then they had the camera ready audition space where they had like lighting and they would like stage you in certain places, like you're waiting. It was part of the kind of illusion of the show, was that they made it seem like you were auditioning in a more camera friendly environment with lighting and like with different set deck and things like that. And we did that. We got passed on to the next round, and then we went to we basically went to the show. And the mistake that I made was that the producers kept insisting that I come up with something brand new just for the show. Because at that point, Todd and I, along with my manager, Tiffany Richards, we had traveled the world doing a live show of Master Ken. And so we had battle-tested bits that people loved. We had performed a bunch of times. We had stuff that we knew the crowd was going to love. And the producers kept rejecting it and kept rejecting it and saying, like, no, we want something different, want something different. And so we came up with something that we had never done before. And they said, yeah, that's it, that's it. And it's such a fatiguing experience to be on a show like that. The day before they shoot the episode, they interviewed us for like 4 hours. And then they had us do improv, like little improvised skits, for like another 4 hours. They didn't feed us, by the way. They just had donuts and stuff. Or like we got hassled at one point because Joe and I were just starving, and there was like a restaurant across the street, and they were like, "Where are you going?" And like, "We're going to get some food." And they're like, "Well, you can't do that." And we were like, "We're gonna do that because we're not gonna just sit here and, be kicked around for 8 hours and not eat any food. Like, that's crazy. Like, we'll be back in an hour." And so we came back and we filmed all day, and then the next day we did the episode. And on the episode, when we went out on stage, I was so nervous. And then Howie and Simon were asking us questions, and I just said whatever came into my head, and the crowd started laughing. And I was like, oh, okay, we're okay. Like, we're gonna be fine. The biggest mistake that I made in that moment was not just, I should have just leaned over to Joe and been like, we're gonna do our stuff, not the producer stuff. I didn't do that. And so I started doing the terrible bit that the producers encouraged us to do. And Heidi hit the buzzer on my first punchline. So it threw the timing of the beginning of the act off. And then I started to try to do my second setup. And the other, who's the other judge? the Spice Girl.
Oh, I honestly don't even
Yeah, I don't even remember, but
know.
like then she hit the buzzer and then the crowd started booing. And so I'm trying to do my bit, and now, and I mind you, I've had rough shows at this point, but I have never in my life been booed off stage. Never. And so I'm in Pasadena. Me and Joe are in Pasadena, and there's about, I don't know, 1,000 people in this massive theater in the audience, and they're all booing. And I'm trying to get through my bit, and then we just get the rest of the buzzers happen, and then we walk off stage. And I was so devastated. I was like, you know, and thinking this is going to be on television. Like, this is going to be like me blowing this opportunity is going to be on TV. And months later, when it came out, thank God, like we got montaged, you know, like it was, I think the clip that they aired was like 20 seconds, 25 seconds, something like that. And I was so relieved because I thought they were going to show the whole horrible, you know, like going down the tubes, you know, steadily losing the audience of being booed kind of thing. But the best thing about it, because it really broke my heart, I'd never been booed off stage in my life, and it was so embarrassing. And I was contractually obligated to do a performance 2 weeks later at a martial arts business summit, which thank God I was, because if I wasn't, I probably just would have quit. I probably just would have been like, well, and I think even in my head, I was like, well, I'll go do this performance because I signed a contract to do it. But after that, I'm not going to perform anymore. And I went out to six, you know, the event was 600 martial arts school owners, my core fan base, you know, the people who love my stuff. And I was kind of fearless in that moment because I thought, you know what? No matter how bad this show goes, it can't be worse than America's Got Talent. Like, I can't, there's no way that this martial arts business summit is going to be worse than what I just experienced 2 weeks ago. So I was kind of fearless. And the show went great. Like, they were excited to see me. They laughed at my jokes. They gave me a standing ovation when I left. And I thought, okay, the lesson then is I need to do my stuff. I need to do what I think I need to do on stage. And never listen to somebody who doesn't know my act, isn't a fan of what I do. And also, you know, I just have to trust my instincts on it. And because I'd had the thought, like, if you're gonna go on TV, you should probably do your best stuff. But then I ignored my instinct, listened to producers who didn't know me, didn't care about me, didn't know the act, didn't like the act. And so I never did that again. And so it gave me like some really valuable information about how to progress, how to move forward. And I carried that even up to this day. Like, now when I'm asked to do something for Ken that doesn't really feel like I would do it, or something that I just don't like, I just kind of don't do it because I learned that lesson the hard way really early on.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing that, man. The reason I had such a visceral reaction is I will 100%. I got so many stories of just producers ruining an act or producers ruining a show. A lot of times you think the act's falling apart, you know, the talent's not doing well. It's not the talent's fault. It's the producers doing something behind the scenes to unintentionally or sometimes intentionally sabotage them. It happens way more than people think.
Yeah, I had read after that experience, I looked around online for whether or not anybody had a similar experience. And it actually turned out it was quite common. It actually turned out that a lot of people who said, look, I travel the world doing this. This is my job. I'm a professional performer. And they reached out to me, asked me to be on the show, and then they changed everything. Or they didn't accommodate what I needed to do my act the way that I do it when I'm doing it. And it was such a disappointing experience. And so I was relieved that it wasn't just that I sucked and that, you know, that like I'm bad at my job and that nobody likes my stuff. It was that if you're going to do your work, you have to do it the way you know how to do it. And that's a big lesson for, I think, any artist trying to figure out how to make a living at what they do, is like you kind of have to protect your process as best you can, because everybody sort of carves out their own way of doing things, particularly over the years. There isn't really any one way to do things. And if you zero in on the best way for you to deliver quality work that you're satisfied with, you got to protect that process and be like, this is how I work and this is how I get the best results, as long as it's working. If it's not working, you should be open to changing your process. But because I've traveled around the world and had great shows and really, you know, had experiences where people have really liked the work, I've had that confidence sort of built up over the years to know what I need to do in order to have a good show.
And with that, I think the last question while we still have you here is, let's talk briefly either about Paper Tigers or, you know, some of the other stuff you've been in acting wise. You know, maybe Paper Tigers is the perfect movie to end off on, because obviously it almost feels like you went full circle. You're almost portraying a character in that movie that's like, if Master Ken were to become an actor and like sort of got over his ego, right? That's sort of your character almost.
Yeah, that's so Paper Tigers was an incredible experience. That was another door that Master Ken kind of opened for me, because the producers of the movie knew who Master Ken was. They liked the videos. I had a conversation with the director, Bao, and the producer, Yuji. Yuji Akimoto, who played the bad guy in Karate Kid 2 and had a resurgence of his career recently in Cobra Kai. And it turned out Yuji knew a stunt coordinator that I worked with on a movie called Odd Thomas. Al Goto was the stunt coordinator, and my name came up, and Al was like, oh, I know Matt. Like, you guys should totally talk to him. So we had this great conversation. They sent me the script. I loved it. And then I didn't hear anything for a year. And I thought, man, I must have really blown that interview. I thought that I did a good job, you know? And I sent them demos of, like, they sent me some kung fu postures and forms, because I don't know kung fu. So they sent me some things to mimic. And so I did my best with that, sent them videos and everything. And then, you know, nothing happened for a year. And then I was coming back from, Joe and I were coming back from a Master Ken Live performance. And I got a phone call from Bao saying, hey, we're greenlit. We start in 6 weeks. You know, do you want to be in the movie? And I was like, yeah, of course I do. They flew me out to LA a week later for like a 1 week crash course in kung fu choreography. And like 8 hours a day. Like, I was in so much pain. It was great training, but I don't train 8 hours a day, you know? And so I would like crawl up the stairs to my hotel room, and I was so sore that I would make sure that once I got into the hotel room, I would try to do everything that I needed to do that required standing up. I'd like take a shower and turn on the air conditioning and make sure I had my food next to the bed, because once I laid down, I didn't want to move because I was in so much pain from doing kung fu all day. But it was a great crash course. Ken, who played the bad guy in the movie, was the fight choreographer. Ron Juan was a great co-star. They were all great co-stars. But Ron Juan and I got along really well, but we were competing with each other. That's another story that I remember about being on set with him, is that my first day on set, I didn't know they were improvising. I didn't know that improv was going to be part of it. So when I had my first scene, it was the funeral scene, and I was super nervous because I wanted to do a good job. And in the conversation with Ron, he started improvising all these insults, and I got flustered and I couldn't think of what to say. And so I kind of fumbled a little bit, and then we broke for lunch, and I was like, you can't let this happen. You can't have somebody outdo you on the first day. Like, you have to get him back. So I went off, I like grabbed my food and then went and sat by myself. And I was thinking of insults that I could throw at Ron, because they hadn't done my coverage yet. They were going to come around and get my close up after lunch. And so I came up with all this stuff, and I started just rattling it off, and I could hear the camera crew laughing. And like, the director was like shushing the camera crew, being like, shh, don't laugh over the takes. You're like, you know, we have to get good audio on this. And so that sort of set the tone where Ron and I were competing with insulting each other for the rest of the movie, trying to figure out who could have the best zinger. And that elevated the movie. And then thankfully Bao wrote a lot of really great stuff that the script was already great, but he also chose to keep a lot of the improv in the movie. A lot of the actors improvised some things that ended up fitting into the movie, and I was so grateful that he was open to that because it was such a great showcase for me as an actor. I'd never gotten that much screen time doing something funny. And it was a character that was similar enough to Master Ken, but also different enough from Master Ken that it was something that still felt new to me. So that was a really incredible experience. The only other thing I want to make sure that I talk about briefly while I'm here is I was able to direct my first movie. Actually, the experience on Paper Tigers, not just acting in the movie, but going on tour with the movie and doing Q&As and doing screenings and meeting people and talking about the movie really inspired me. And I really wanted to make, I'd always wanted to direct my own feature film. And I had a script sitting around called Cop versus Killer. And it was something that I decided to do about 2 years later, I think. And I'm so glad that I did. It was an incredibly hard thing, but it was just, I star in the film. I wrote it. I directed it. My girlfriend produced it. It was a co-production between my company and a company called Triangle U Studios in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, where we shot. A buddy of mine, Kevin Conan Bankins, played the villain in the movie. He's a great martial artist, Hoist Gracie black belt, and we had just such a great time. There's so much that's a whole other thing. But like, if anybody's interested in seeing me do anything outside of Paper Tigers or Master Ken, Cop versus Killer, it's available on Tubi. It's available on Amazon. It's kind of an action thriller, sort of like I sort of compare it to like it's somewhere between like No Country for Old Men and that movie Death Warrant by Jean-Claude Van Damme, or like Nowhere to Run, like the sort of weird subgenre of martial arts movie where like it's got martial arts in it, but it's kind of more of a thriller type thing. So yeah, I'm really proud of it. It was really hard to make. And it's available now, and I would love for people to check it out.
Cool. I'm saving this for Tubi right now. This is great. I
Yes,
love using Tubi. I love it. The thing that came to mind as you were telling me about this, remember Quan Kicker?
He was one of the first YouTubers that I connected with when I first got onto YouTube.
Yeah. Quan Kicker, basically, he always martial arts was his second thing. He always was producing stuff film-wise.
I
So I need to
remember that he
connect
was
you
doing
guys. Like,
things
I need
that
to
felt
show him
like,
your stuff, and then, yeah, you can see some of his stuff.
I remember that he was doing things that had like storylines and characters and like scripted things that were much more like movies.
And that's why he kind of retired from YouTube, because he was like, I'm doing too much on YouTube. I'd rather just focus my attention doing the more producing, directing stuff I always wanted to do. So,
That's really cool.
yeah.
And that's this battle that I feel like a lot of creators have right now is that trying to find the cross section between doing the work you really want to do and also creating the content that gets the response, that reaches the audience, that generates the revenue, that allows you to do what you want to do. And it's a moving target. Every year I figure something out about it, and every year it changes. And I'm like in that battle right now. I'm like revamping a bunch of things about my channel. We just hit the 1 million subscriber mark, which I'm so proud of. And yet there are things that I've been wanting to do with my channel for years that I haven't done. And I'm kind of saying like, if I don't do it now, when am I going to do it? Kind of a thing. I'm trying to figure out like how and when I can do this, and just sort of like taking the initiative this year to be like, I've just got to figure it out. I've got to figure out how to still do the type of content that is, I hate to say it this way, but like sort of faster to produce, that gets some of the views, but also the content that takes a lot more time and thought and production, because I'm by like, I love filmmaking so much. And hang on, my dog is get my little dog.
Oh, so
She wants
cute.
attention right now, so I have to hold her, otherwise she's gonna bark over the thing. But like I love the filmmaking process so much. I love I love picking a lens and like, you know, looking at a scene and like trying to make something look cinematic and also working with a crew and actors and creating special effects and doing fun, cool stuff that really requires thought and time and applies the craft of filmmaking. And yet it's so hard to fit a lot of that into the YouTube world. So it's kind of a battle. It's a real battle. So it's something I'm still trying to figure out. Doing Cop versus Killer really reinvigorated my love for that process. And yet I'm still trying to figure out how to fuse that process with the YouTube stuff. Because I noticed that a lot of creators are doing some really interesting things that feel a lot more like filmmaking. Like they're trying to do better lighting, they're trying to have a second camera, they're trying to do more unique things visually. They're really trying to put a lot of work into that. And so I'm super interested in that stuff. I'm just trying to figure out how to make it fit into the YouTube world.
Yeah, I'm trying to show you my camera right now because again, like
Yeah, what do you got?
I got some filmmaking cameras too, but I
What do you
never
got in
pulled
there?
this out. It's a Blackmagic camera.
I it's
Yeah.
you're killing me. I've got a Blackmagic camera in the closet behind me.
Yeah.
And you know what I shoot most of my show on right now?
Yeah, exactly.
My
I
phone.
shoot all my talk to the camera stuff with this too. Dude, Matt,
Because
we need to do another conversation. Let's just
we do.
talk about this part. Like, you and I could probably talk for 3 hours about this, but I think
I
we have
know.
some of the similar experiences and similar thoughts about this stuff.
Yeah, we're getting well. I can get
Yeah.
geeked out on this stuff
Yeah.
forever. So, like, I hope
Yeah.
the people who are curious, who were curious about Master Ken, got some interesting insight about that and martial arts content and everything. But I, at my heart, I am constantly battling with the martial arts geek inside of me and the filmmaking geek inside of me because I want them to be able to work together as much as they can. And sometimes I can't figure out how to do that.
Exactly. So I think let's do another conversation. Let's really talk about the filmmaking aspect of it. Let's really dive in. I think we
That'd
would
be
have a
great.
great 1 hour or 2 hour conversation about that. So guys, another conversation with Matt to come. And then in the future, please leave your questions for Master Ken. I think we're gonna bring Master Ken on one time and like talk.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll get Ken on here and he'll talk some smack for some people.
Yeah, definitely. So dude, Matt, thank you so much, man. This was an awesome conversation.
Thank you for having me. I love talking about this. I appreciate you bringing me on your show and look forward to doing it again.
Definitely. Contact me anytime. Seriously, I'm down even to do once a month or if you're interested. And another thing, I would love to invite you to join almost like a YouTuber slash filmmaker mastermind group if you want to join.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome. I'm
Quan
always,
Kinker's in that group too. So
that's
we can
great because I'm always looking at, I'm watching videos all the time about process, about where the industry is, about how to create, how to connect, how to improve. So bring me into it. I'm all about it.
That's awesome. Okay, so you're in. All right, perfect, perfect. So, guys, a lot to come. I will stop here now. And I'll kind of talk to you maybe for 2 more minutes after this. So,
Yeah, great.
everyone, Fight Commentary Breakdowns and Master Ken AK and Matt Page enter the Dojo show, and I will link Riff Raff Entertainment to the channel so you guys can find that. He's got some good stuff on there.
Perfect.